and welcome everyone to the Nikhil Hogan Show. What an honor to speak with my guest today, harpsichordist, organist, keyboardist, conductor, composer, and improviser, Professor Matteo Messori. He is the founder of the Cappella Augustana Ensemble, and his latest recording is the complete harpsichord and organ works by Johann Kaspar Kerll, a new 3-CD box. Professor Messori, welcome to the Nikhil Hogan Show.
Thank you very much. Have a good day.
Can you share with me a little bit about your background? How did you get started in music?
I started to study piano at the age of four with Maria Laura Cirillo, a former student of my future piano teacher in the Conservatory of Bologna. At the age of 11, I enrolled to the Bologna Conservatory, where I studied piano at first with Franca Fogli, who was actually the first student of Arturo Benedetti Michelangeli in the 1940-41. Yes, so he was a professor in Bologna when he was 20 years old, and she was the first student by him. After a couple of years, I moved to study organ and organ composition. In Italy, the class is organ and composition organistica under Umberto Pineschi. At the same time, I started to study privately harpsichord with Francesco Cera from Bologna, like me. And soon, the desire to deepen my knowledge of the harpsichord repertoire brought me to study with another Bolognese, Sergio Vartolo, at first in the Conservatory of Mantua and then in Venice. But since I was a child, I used to listen to the many recordings of Sergio Vartolo. He was also Maestro di Cappella in San Petronio, the main church of Bologna, with a very long musical history. I was also extremely influenced by the historically informed recordings by Harnon Kua, and I was especially impressed by his profoundly Viennese musicality, which I took as a model, for example, with regard to the dynamics, in a sense, to the chiaroscuro. As a young boy, I felt the urge to play on a clavichord, also to own a clavichord, in order to imitate the cantabile style, typical of the singing and of the bowed instruments. I was always convinced that a clavichord is the most sensible and intimate keyboard instrument. So what was of fundamental importance and influence for me was also the cantata cycle, which Arnon Kur, together with Leonard, were still recording in the 80s. Another important point of reference, I think, were Leonard harpsichord and organ recordings, which I used to buy in the local record store here in Bologna. I must admit that the musical environment here in Bologna was really a cultural melting pot, rich with intellectual and artistic ferment, especially in the early music field. And so I was really lucky to be born in a town rich of cultural stimuli, renowned traditionally as a cradle of the academic erudition, but at the same time, full of pleasure-loving, also in the gastronomic field. I had the chance to communicate and exchange opinions on a regular basis with such a fundamental authority like as Luigi Ferdinando Tagliavini, who, besides having directed the restoration works on the San Petronio organs, has also started to collect original Italian harpsichords and spinets. I remember seeing his collection for the first time as a young boy during a public exposition here in Bologna, and being impressed by his personality, which I already had a chance to get to know thanks to the concerts I attended in San Petronio very early.
Did you always improvise and compose music growing up when you were young?
Yeah, I started my first musical attempts were composing, was to compose, yes. I tried to compose when I was 4 years old, I think. And I have still, I started to play when I was four, and in the same time I started to try to compose. I have my my notebooks here, and of course very very simple things like four or five notes imitations. And then I was very impressed by Bach music from the very beginning, and so I tried to write some fugettas or canons, like one at the right hand started, and the left repeated the same things. So very simple things, but the improvisation was a little bit later. But I'm not really an improviser in sense of. Like many colleagues of me, I'm a good improviser on the continuo bass, I think. On Partimenti, I'm not so very so good like I would like to be in the free improvisation, I think. Or I need a little bit more time to think. I compose, of course, and my composition starts from my fingers, but. Yes, of course, I played all this organ, little improvisation, very simple style, like Partimento style during the liturgy when I was organist in church. But and I teach it, of course, how to improvise a little choral prelude. But I really not so good, so great.
Well, I think you're just being incredibly modest, but we will get to Partimento really shortly. I want to ask you about Bologna. So Partimento, from what I understand, is the Neapolitan tradition with the Leonardo Leo and Francesco Durante. But tell me a little bit about Bologna, and what's the difference between Bologna and Naples when it comes to Partimento?
Yes, so this is a very, very important and also discussed thing. I see the things in a way a little bit different from many scholars and from other colleagues. So the Partimento, what is Partimento in general? Partimento is a part of basso seguente that was invented or used very early, I think, and we have the first samples of organo written like basso seguente at the end of the 16th century. So in Rome we have Palestrina masses with organ part as basso seguente manuscript, and maybe also printed at the end of the 16th century. This was called in South Italy, more or less, also in Bologna, maybe Montalbano. He was active in Bologna as Partimento, but Partimento is a part, an organ part to accompany the singing choir, the singing ensemble. So, of course, this created a lot of problems because in the same time, the musical didactic approach was that of contrapunto and contrapunto alla mente. So counterpoint and improvising counterpoint. And so this hiatus, this separation between continuo keyboard player and real true organists who were able to play from a score in four clefs or in five clefs. This was a big problem. So the first the first musicians who used normally continuo as a medium, a standard to compose vocal music, for example, Schutt, for example, Banchieri, they were against the growing losing of counterpoint. Frescobaldi, for example, published the Fiori Musicali, like all his keyboard polyphonic works in score in four clefs, and I've always played since my childhood in such a way, thanks to my organ professor and my harpsichord professor, Opinski and Vato, and still all my students play frescobaldi from score. I have recorded Bach Art of Fugue in 4 clefs, the musical offering Richard Carey in 6 clefs, also Francesco Cera, student by student of Bartol.
Can I ask you a quick question, Professor Messori? How do you learn to do that? Is it just sit down and do it? Is there any tips to learn how
yes,
to do that?
Many people also recently in Poland, I was teaching a master class with wonderful harpsichord students in Poznan, and they asked me, how can you read so good score in 4 clefs? And I started when I was a child, and so maybe the difficult things are easier when you are younger. But also my students normally started since the beginning to do it. And also some very good pianists in Bergamo, where I teach harpsichord, I've tried to play some Richard Carey by Frescobaldi or some Capriccio, the best student in 4 clefs, and they study a lot, but they are able to do it. Of course, for some people, like always, it's easier. For some, it's more difficult. But personally, I find very difficult to read a score with a modern choir clefs. So the octave, the treble clefs in octave now for me is incredibly difficult to read. This created a big separation between the organists who were only able to play continuo or partimenti, and the professional organists who were able to improvise, to write, to read motets, fugues, imitations, and so Battiferri, a student by Frescobaldi, lamented this situation, this hiatus between continuisti and real organists. And in this moment, we have the first partimenti that are not from Naples, absolutely not, and that are, as I have written, for example, in my preface of the edition of this anonymous partimenti recently found, discovered by me here in Bologna, the oldest partimenti existing after Banchieri. I have written that the origin of partimento practice, like didactical and organ improvisation method, was between Rome and Bologna, for sure. So in the church state, and the first city of church state was Rome, the second and the much bigger city in that moment was Bologna. And Bologna was often... also later, it's a bit Corelli times, the one of the schools, the music schools, who prepared the musician, and they went to Rome to work. So the oldest partimento we have for solo organ are the verset by Banchieri in the organo suonarino. These are printed and are famous. This second oldest collection I found here in Bologna is anonymous, is handwritten. I think it could be from Bologna, from the Roman state, so between Umbria, some Tuscany, maybe Marche, but I think something from Rome or from Bologna, why not? And these are canzonas and verses for organ, just fugues, still in the tradition post-Zerlino tradition. So where you must dominate alamente counterpoint in order to work on this music, that are fantastic pieces, but still between the 12 tones and the new sense of modern tonality. No? So to Naples, it was a little bit later, the very famous Naples conservatories took this didactical and practical improvising system from Rome, and they used maybe from Gaetano Greco or something, also before, a little bit before, why not? So it was normal to study the practical improvisation, the practical departamento, so the continuous improvisation on on the figures, on these figurations, musical figurations that were the basis of the composition at that time. So we have something more contrapuntal and more modal at the beginning, and then more like duo sonatas, trio sonatas, church, modern church music with a passing basses, and so like cello basses, and so now we are a little bit too much focused on the of course is the most important school, the Napolitan school is the most important, maybe because they produced a lot of geniuses who went to worldwide. And in Europe, we have the Paris Conservatory was modeled after Naples. No?
So just because I'm not an expert, is basso continuo still good, or do you prefer that we think more in the pre-basso continuo way, which is more like multiple staves and thinking more independent lines? Or what do you think of the difference between the newer basso continuo and the older way of thinking?
Of course, when musicians arrived to the modern fixed tonalities, so major and minor tonalities, we have now practically only two keys, the major and the minor. Before they used 12 keys, so 8, and then after other 4, no? So the Glarianus, the dodecachordon. And in the keyboard music, in the composition, vocal music and then keyboard music, of course, at the beginning of the 17th century, Frescobaldi had normally still 12 keys, 12 tones. 12 modi, 12 toni, and the passage between these and the modern system with only two keys was a long and very complex, and of course this was a change of fashion. A long fashion change. Schütz told that musicians change fashion every 5 years, and this is completely true. So Schütz, for example, I told before about Schütz. Schütz wrote the most important concertato vocal music above basso continuo, so the Kleingeistische Konzerte, for example. But he wrote also the most important Lutheran polyphonic music of the beginning of the century. For example, the splendid Canzone Sacre, and the Geistliche Chormusik, Musicalia, the Chorum Sacrum. And these works are completely in strict imitative counterpoint. And the organ part was published like basso seguente with figures, numbers. But in the preface, should suggest, like Banchieri, the same in Bologna, that a real organist has to write down the score from the voices, a full score, or a tabulature, in tabulatura, and to play con la parte, so doubling the voices, and not playing just continuo chords, because this is too stupid. So he tells that the real organist, the true organist, yeah, don't play this continuo, was only for commercial reasons, because the editor wants to have a continuo part in order to sell the canzone sacra better.
Yeah.
But the real organist has to, so in my Schütz recording, I have played the polyphonic things from the score in 4 or 5 claps or 6, and the Spitt edition, the old edition by Spitt, that is the best, actually the best Schütz edition existing, like always Spitt, when he won the best musicologist of the history, maybe together with Forkel, the first and the best. And the Spitt edition in 4 claps is very clear, and I canceled the continuo under this polyphonic music, and I played con la parte what I I find to be more interesting. So if there are too many diminutions in the voices, I don't double the diminutions. I make easier the texture, no? But in general, I play con la parte. So, and this was the beginning of the first Partimento. So Banchieri, these canzonas I have published. And the Partimento fugue, also in the Bach age, is the following of this approach. So that you play in horizontal way. Of course, now we study the continuo like a chordal situation. In my didactical experience is this. The first continuo class I do is normally a class where I teach to accompany a duo sonata for soprano instrumental continuo by Handel or by Telemann. And so I teach the octave rule, and how to build its chords, then the progressions, and the student must improvise an accompaniment with chords, no? Normally in four-part texture. And this is the first, the introductory continuo class. The second year, I moved to Partimento. And then the situation is much different because I try to teach, showing, and also to listening other my version, other version, how and the original realization of Partimento are very few, but there are, and how to deepen the cantabile sense of the right hand. And so I normally we teach only the modern tonal system, so after Corelli, from Corelli, because the modern composition is I teach counterpoint with Fuchs and in modern way, but is a neo Palestinian counterpoint, that of Fuchs, with is not Zarlino really. I studied it. I will tell you maybe with Giorgio Pacchioni, Maestro Pacchioni, one of the most expert of historical Italian deductive approach. And I was for 2 years. I played harpsichord in his recorded class in Bologna. But he was professor of historical counterpoint, and we did a lot of contrapunti alla mente canons rigorously in Renaissance style.
So I get the sense that you teach it. You're not teaching like Fenaroli or Furno and that sort of thing. Are you teaching it in a different way? Because most people, when they think of Partimento, they think, okay, I'm going to read the Regulae by Fenaroli, or I'll read the Regulae by Furno, and then I work that way. How do you work when you teach Partimento?
For the undergraduate harpsichord and organ students, I hold the first introductory class where we work on easy Handel and Telemann sonatas for soprano. And I introduce at the first the rule of the octave, and we work on the construction of its various chords. From the very beginning, I try to increase my students' awareness of the intervals above the bass, as indicated by figures and by numbers, and I insist on dismissing and forgetting the theory of fundamental bass and of the inversions. This is one of the most important things, because very often they arrive with a normal, standard, modern harmony classes with post-Rameau theories that are completely not important and also confusing when you improvise, I think. We then work on the progressions of descending fifth. We make some exercise on the use of the ninth, or the fourth, the seventh. We work also on the construction of the cadences. This is one very important thing. Then we moved on the accompaniment of the sonatas, but in a chordal way.
So you're using Handel and Telemann. Do you use any other Partimenti?
No, at the beginning, no. I write some Partimenti for the progressions, but the last times I use the Libro per Accompagnare by Padre Martini from Bologna.
Ah, okay.
And back because it's a tutorial with every kind of Baroque bass movement. So, and there also a friend of mine, Peter Vantua, has published it. I have also other manuscript exercises by Martini, Partimento exercises here in Bologna, and I use often them.
Why is his collection excellent? Is it because it contains everything?
Because it contains everything we need for Italian Baroque music, I think. This is not completely, not the same approach in comparison with the Germans. No? Of course, my first love and my unique love is Johann Sebastian Bach. And if you compare Bach, but the difference are a little bit in the Lutheran didactical approach, also the goals of the organist. The Catholic organist from Martini age has to play continuo with voices and instruments, has to improvise short verses between the Gregorian chant, but also this improvisation of verses that was the job, the organist job, was in the big churches was not so important because you play mostly continuo with voices and instruments in the big churches. So, the Lutheran organist had to improvise or to a prelude between the singing of a choral. So they developed much more the sense of cantus firmus in the soprano, in the treble. And so for the French became the chant donné, canto dato. So they worked on the soprano lines, and they used the partimento with multiple basses under the soprano in order to build the accompaniment of the choral. So Bach
used partimenti.
Bach, I think, I'm not only me, but of course also Derek Remesh is studying a lot of these problems, and many other people. Bach, for sure, after the first tabulatura study, so studio dell'intavolatura, the old Italian told, so the study of the keyboard literature, written in full, after all temperita scavia, the well-tempered clavichord, Bach started to teach continuo. And I think he used his system. There are two short continuo treatises by Bach, no? Not complete, but one is quite long and one of the best tutorial. And they are a concentrate of Heineken and Kenner. Bach has to teach continuo in this way. So the study of the octave rule, the construction of the chords, the figures numbering, what means the progressions, and then they started to Bach gave for the organist a choral melody to put in the treble in the soprano, and you had. And at the beginning, Bach wrote a bass with numbers, and the organist, the student, had to improvise the two inner parts in close position for the improvisation, and also writing down in open position.
Now, I'm very interested to talk about Padre Martini, and so how was the Bologna different then? So, and also different from Naples.
The difference from Bologna and Naples, not so big. I will tell you a little bit, but what I think. But there are of course many different things, but not so substantial, like between Lutheran and Catholic approach, because the Catholic approach had not anymore the cantus firmus, so the choral. We have not the choral, and people couldn't sing in the church, only the cappella, the professional musicians, and they played figurated music, so musica figurata, new compositions in the style of the age. But the Lutheran used every Sunday the chorals, big collections of hundreds and hundreds of chorals, and this was the must for the organist. So the Catholic, the Italian tradition of Baroque, late Baroque age era, was founded on not on the treble, the cantus firmus in soprano, but on the continuo bass.
Oh, so the bass Germans comes first.
The German, yes, of course. The Germans, both situations, the choral in the soprano, and the partimento like accompanying of this choral. So a number, a figure, bass, and the other two parts. And then there is a substantial difference between Italy and Germany, and also France. Germany and France taught continuo in four voices. So Die Kunst des reinen Satzes, Kirchberger, what means the art of the pure writing. The pure writing, the pure composition, is a four-part composition. For Italians of Martini age, of Leo age, of Durante age, the keyboard approach of Partimento was not substantially in four parts. Was normally a three-part harmony. Was a substantial three-part harmony, who very often became a two-part keyboard writing. If you see Scarlatti sonatas, that are the most important Partimento realization of ideal Partimento we have, or the approach by Domenico Scarlatti, also his father, Alessandro, is a little bit older, but of course, Domenico Scarlatti is in the same moment of Durante. Alessandro Scarlatti is a little bit older, but you see that the main new Italian fashion from Frescobaldi in four parts in score, we arrived to a very simple gallant style in two parts for keyboard. So the right hand and so Padre Martini, for example, the first opus, the first keyboard collection by Padre Martini, the most important collection written maybe if you forget Domenico Scarlatti, that is one of the biggest musical figures of the history, the most important printed collection of the first part of the century in Italy is for sure the 12 sonatas by Padre Martini, 12 sonate di intavolatura per cembalo organo. And this work written by the young Martini is the only answer to the German influences of Handel, who Martini knew very good. Martini had the suite by Handel. We have the edition here in Bologna. And of the first Klavierübung by Bach, the Partitas by Bach. Martini had the edition very early, for sure. And in the 12 sonatas, in the 12 sonatas, he wrote fugues and many movements that are on the subject and with Partimento movements taken by Bach and Handel. And Martini told to the student Padre Paolucci, the author of this counterpoint treatise, Arte Pratica di Contrappunto, told that intavolatura for him is when you play three or four or five obbligato parts on the keyboard. One thing forgotten by most Italians that played only one per hand, two parts. And so the second work, keyboard work by Martini, is very gallant and simple, yep. Because the first was so difficult to play that anybody was able, and so was a tremendous disaster, economic disaster for the publisher, and also for Martini, who paid for it. And so he published six very simple sonata fundamentally in two parts. And these two-part sonata are one of the examples how to realize a Partimento. If you take only the continuo, the bass of this sonata, you have splendid Partimentos in Bolognese way that are like duo sonatas for violin and continuo. And so Bach used a four-part teaching for obbligato part, because the Germans remained a little bit always more Italian than Italian. Italians invented always new fashions,
yeah,
but the Germans were a little bit like late, no? But of course not in the harmony, but in the fashion. So they loved, and this I think is important, the Lutheran Church, they loved the tradition, the Catholic tradition, the highest. Josquin was the favorite composer for Luther, and in Bach also there is a tradition of counterpoint, of vocal polyphony in that we forget, and because our counterpoint in the Partimento, in the Fenaroli, or before in the Durante age, is a Partimento made more and more on the regola dell'ottava, on the octave rule, not on the cantus firmus, Gregorian cantus firmus, no? Like Zarlino, or like. So we had a tonal counterpoint who became the Dubois counterpoint, the Cherubini counterpoint in Paris in the 19th
century. Can I ask Professor Messori, how does solfeggio play now into this art of Partimento? Because you mentioned that it comes from the bass, but then there's also, they did a lot of singing, right?
Yes, so we know from Naples conservatory system, and also the same in Bologna, where there were not conservatories, but there were the school, the Bologna school, so a school of singing, first of all. Since the half of the 17th century, we produced here in Bologna the most important singers of the world. I think Tupistocchi, Bernacchi, Farinelli. So, and even in my century, so the last century, we had Pavarotti and Mirella Freni, so from Modena, 30 kilometers from here, and a student in Bologna of Leone Magera, very good pianist and vocal coach,
right.
teacher. And so we have this vocality that was the solfeggio tradition. What is solfeggio? In the Zarlino age was the singing of ricercari with solmization, ut re mi fa sol la, ut re mi fa sol re mi fa, these things, and then became the new bel canto style. So a lot of diminutions. Of course, the diminution starts in the Renaissance. If you think to Zasco Luzzaschi in madrigals for the Dama in Ferrara, we have the most virtuosistic diminutions maybe of the century. But in the new tonal, modern tonal system, they produced solfeggio for the child, for the children, who at the very beginning, they studied for 3 years only solfeggio. So they sang as soprano, and there was the master, who was the vocal, the master of solfeggio, the master of counterpoint, of partimento, of keyboard, the same person. So they started to sing this solfeggio, very difficult, with study of messa di voce, scale, trilli, diminutions, arpeggios, so everything. And then they, after 3 years normally, they were allowed to study the keyboard. Everybody.
But then you
keyboard.
Said the keyboard, it's the partimento comes from the bass, right? The harmony. But you're
yes,
also, how does that compare? Because the solfeggio is from the treble, right?
Yes. So the mixture of these two tendencies, the didactic tendencies, the solfeggios were to sing, but were also models how to use the right hand during improvisation. Were the models how to write for a violin. At the very beginning, the children, the students in the conservatories in Naples, or under Padre Martini, or under Bernacchi, or under Giovanni Paolo Colonna here in Bologna, Giacomo Antonio Perti, they started to sing and to imitate the messa di voce, the dynamics of the singing, the expression, the expression. Why there were not expression markings? So because everybody knew how to sing from the very beginning. So it was not important for a keyboard player to tell how to do a crescendo dynamic sense at the harpsichord or the organ. everybody were able to play violin, to sing, and to play a good continuo realization, or also improvise the fugue in Partimento form. So maybe everybody. Vivaldi was a violinist and could do it. Farinelli was a singer. Every morning played the harpsichord or fortepiano for 3-4 hours.
And wow!
So this was a famous, normal system.
And so normal system.
See, the normal system of that age, and they produced a lot of very good artisans and geniuses who could write an opera in 1 week.
Okay, so but to go back to the thing, there's two streams, thinking from the bass but also thinking from the treble, and it just happens at the same time.
Yes, but of course they studied how to create diminutions, ornamentation of the bass. And of course the models were the solfeggios. That were written, the solfeggios were maybe something. If you see the two-part solfeggios for soprano and bass, I have recently played some solfeggios in concerts, keyboard concerts, because there are so many. For example, the Righini solfeggios. Vincenzo Righini was from Bologna, maybe student under Padre Martini, and he was one of the best opera composer in Germany and in Prague in the second half of the 18th century. And Vincenzo Righini was also a model for some variations by Beethoven. Vincenzo Righini wrote some solfeggi so famous and so beautiful that I decided to play in a fortepiano concert some solfeggios by him. And I, of course, have added chords, parts between the soprano and the continuo, but in general I played the solfeggios like Sturm und Drang music.
You mentioned Padre Martini. Now, he's such a great teacher. Isn't it true that even several Neapolitans, they left Naples to come to Bologna just to be trained by him, so like Pasquale Cafaro and Saverio Valente,
yeah,
right? Now, why would they leave the famous Naples and go and study in Bologna?
I think he was one of the biggest learned men of the century, really. We have still one of the most splendid library, music library of the history. And he was very good as a teacher, I think, and so learned, and the character was so nice, and every student, also Mozart, wrote some many times that Padre Martini was the best people he have never met in the life. Huh? So I think that Johann Christian Bach, so the last son of Johann Sebastian Bach, was in Bologna to study counterpoint after Carl Philipp Emanuel in Berlin with under Padre Martini. So I think the Bologna school was the singing school, and a city like Naples, the two Italian schools were Bologna in that age and Naples. The importance maybe is Naples and Bologna, but Naples was on the south, for the south, and Bologna for the north, Italy.
Can you tell me how Padre Martini taught? What was his teaching method?
I think he started with this libro per accompagnare, this very simple bass movements in Partimento form. I think they played mostly at the keyboard in three parts, so three voices, because also for example, the Bolognese system of Partimento is different from Naples, because we used normally always numbers.
Oh, you have
Bolognese
figures.
In the Partimento tradition, we have always figures. And in the last years of the Partimento tradition in Bologna, we have so many numbers. We have sometimes also three numbers per note. So the four-part texture. For example, the Bolognese tradition could be these 25 canzonas steel model I have discovered and published for Il Levante, also Banchieri, this. And then in the new tonal system, we have the Partimenti by Saratelli. This is a wonderful collection. I use more and more during my lessons. And they are in 24 keys. And this is another characteristic of Bologna, peculiarity of Bologna school, of Baroque age. The Partimento studied in all 24 keys. No? And then we have Padre Martini. There are Partimenti that are maybe, I'm sure, of Padre Martini in Modena. There are other manuscript handwritten Partimentos here in Bologna, a lot also. And then we have, the Mattei tradition, the most important student by Martini, for his teacher is Padre Mattei. And he was, of course, the professor of the young Rossini, or the young Donizetti.
Can I ask Professor Messori, what's the difference between having no figures and having figures? Is it better to have numbers, or it doesn't matter?
It's easier. It's easier to have numbers, of course. The German system, the collection I love at most is the Ristori, the Italian collection I love more, are the Esercizi per l'accompagnamento by Ristori. And this collection was for sure written in Dresden for the Saxony duchesses, particularly for Maria Walpurgis of Bavaria. And Ristori, who studied in Bologna for sure, he was born in Vienna, but he studied in Bologna, it seems. And Ristori used the figures, the numbers, because the Germans wanted to have the numbers like the French. And Bologna also. But in Naples, the goal of the Partimento, the goal of the musicians, because Partimento was a didactic way to learn music from the beginning. So the goal was to write masses and, if even better, operas. So and the goal was to be so fast to improvise, to understand music, that you don't need at all numbers, figures. So you don't need anything. You see the bass movement, and you recognize immediately which are the possibilities
Is that better, or is that or what do you think? Is that better, or
is much better
to have no numbers?
It's much more professional. Don't have numbers, because it's much more difficult. It's the highest level, I think. Now, the highest level in absolute when you improvise without any basis, so free improvisation. You sit down at the keyboard and you play. But the exercise in order to arrive to this level is to start with Partimento. So the famous Partimenti numerati by Durante are normally without numbers in the most copies, but maybe were at the beginning with some numbers. But the Naples school, but also Padre Martini, the Libro per Accompagnare, he gives the figures, but often after the first explication there are any more numbers, because you know, you understand that movement of the bass requires these numbers or other possibilities of numbers, of course. So the Germans wanted to have numbers, maybe because the didactical system was not so long and professional like the Naples conservatories, where they studied 10 years.
Now you are writing the foreword for the upcoming publication of Stanislaw Mattei's Scales and Versets for all major keys and minor keys, 1788, three Partimento realizations from the Ricasoli collection, edited by the great Peter Ventur. Now, tell me about Mattei, and how is he different from Martini?
So, first of all, I want to tell that my tastes are more Baroque, and so I prefer the school, the compositions, the style the playing of the first part of the century. So I prefer absolutely Durante than Fenaroli. I prefer Padre Martini than Padre Mattei. I prefer the Bach Handel than Albert Berger. But this is my personal taste, because but of course the Mattei tradition. I think that Mattei has the same role that Fenaroli has in Naples. So Fenaroli is the student of Durante, maybe the most important student for the didactical thing, and Mattei the most important follower of Padre Martini. Of course, in Padre Martini there is less Italians who are not systematically normally. The German are systematic, the French are systematic, the Italians were, they prepared these Partimento collections are very often imprecise, shortened, because were work in progress for the students. And they speak during the lessons with the students, they didn't like to write explication. So you have Matteson, the Große Generalbassschule by Matteson, that is wonderful. He explains a lot of possibilities how to realize a Partimento, and this is a very didactical, very Lutheran, very German, no? Very
like
Germanical.
A lawyer, right?
Yeah, you see, very like Schütze was a lawyer.
Yeah,
and so there is this approach of when you want to know something about Italians, so you have to read
the Germans.
German tradition. So Pretorius, in order to understand Monteverdi,
right.
Frescobaldi. You have to understand. You
That's
read
so
Heineken
funny.
In order to understand Italian.
Right.
Heineken is more, of course, Heineken is different from Italian. But he went to Venice, to Italy, and he came back. He was in Dresden, Italian city. So, for example, I didn't tell you about my suggestion. I've written about it in the preface of this edition of Anonymous Partimenti. I think that the Saxon tradition of continuo starts from Vincenzo Albrici. I was the only till now who has recorded a CD with a monographic CD on Albrici works, sacred music, and was my very first CD with my ensemble, 2000 in Sweden, and Albrici was a student by Carissimi, under Carissimi. When he was 10, he was the Carissimi organist in Rome, Collegio Germanico, and he went to Sweden, and then to Germany, and he became the favorite maestro di cappella, Kapellmeister, in Dresden. He was Catholic. He came from Jesuits. But he was one of the most influential composers for Lutheran music. So the Membra Jesu Nostri by Buxtehude are a consequence of the Albrici style, of the Roman concerto in Germany, in Lutheran Germany. So also Peranda, Marco Giuseppe Peranda, was his fellow Kapellmeister. And Vincenzo Albrici was a virtuoso keyboard player, and he was also the only Italian organist in the Thomaskirche in Leipzig before Bach, and he became Lutheran for 1 year and a half. And his students were, for example, Kuhnau, for example, Johann Friedrich Alberti, and also maybe Christian Ritter. Christian Ritter was the teacher of Zachow. Zachow was the teacher of Handel and Kirchhoff. Both Handel and Kirchhoff, we know, are composer of important Partimento fugues and prelude and fugues, so the ABC musical, the Kirchhoff. I think that the Roman tradition of playing organ on the basso was taken and widespread in Middle Germany, in the Lutheran culture, also by through Albrecht, I think. And of course, other Lutheran students came to Rome to study with Pasquini. But I have also written it, we have not to forget that Pasquini, Bernardo Pasquini, one of the most important Quartimento composer, one of the first, no? We know Pasquini was student, I think, I suppose, maybe under Battiferri, first quality student, but he spent his first years of studying in Ferrara, so near Bologna, and later he went to Rome. So, and so this I think that the beginning of Partimento tradition, banchieri in Bologna, the first things we have are between Bologna and the Pope plan, the center around Bologna, and Rome in between. So, so maybe all this attention focuses on Naples is important, of course. There are fantastic things, but is a little bit too limited.
Now, let me ask you about Partimento and counterpoint. How do you transition from Partimento to written counterpoint? And can you talk about the connection between Partimento and written counterpoint?
Yes, another good big mistake of today is to separate the two things, because these things are too much connected. So the Partimento was the beginning of the study, and it was a practical harmony. The Partimento was called in France in the Franck age, in the Liszt age, in Chopin age, harmonie pratique au piano. So the practical harmony at the keyboard, at the piano. So this was in the Naples and Bologna and the German conservatories, or school, private school, church school, during the Baroque. They played on the bass at the harpsichord, and had the organ later. This was normal. But the counterpoint, the vocal composition, this was counterpoint, was a further level, a much more important level. So at the beginning, in Zarlino age, we have only counterpoint. Then we have the invention of continuo, so the verticality, growing verticality of the composition, of the cadences, through the numbers, the figures, and so everything became more simple, easier. There is a simplification of the system. But they followed to study counterpoint in a neo-Renaissance manner, like Fuchs, or like the Naples counterpoint on the octave rules, also Padre Mattei. The Mattei counterpoints were built on the octave rule. So we have do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, si, do, they sang ut, re, mi, fa, sol, re, mi, fa, and they compose imitations, double imitations for 3, 4, even 2, 8 voices on this new harmonic system, so on the key, on the scale of the tonality. But the goal was to be able to compose a fugue for choir and orchestra, to prepare a mass for the liturgy, and then, of course, the models of these partimenti, this figuration of the basses, are very useful in order to compose an aria for an opera. If you put four strings above, you put a voice, you have models to do a ritornello, orchestra ritornello, to develop through solfeggio study a line, vocal line, and so everything is connected. And we make a mistake to separate the Partimento, like a post-chordal study, from the counterpoint, horizontal counterpoint, that is vocal composition made in score. We still in Italy study the fugue in four clefs. When we study composition, we have to compose in four clefs the fugue. For example, this difference is clear in the Italian conservatories programs. I studied organ and organ composition, and we had to compose for the after 8 years of course a two parts fuguetta for organ, and at the final exam a three part fuguetta for organ, and a motet for voice and organ. But the composers, the main composing studies, they had to compose after 7 years a four part fugue with counter subject, in the Italian vocal tradition, so Cherubini, Dubois, Gedages, the Vallotti tradition of the fugue, four voices without text, like a Kyrie or like Amen, in vocal style, or a neo mixture of neo instrumental and vocal style, for four parts and not for organ. So we had still in our organ studies the practical Partimento approach of the old tradition, and the composers had the highest level of the vocal composition of the church, choir, and also orchestra composition, of course. So I think that the Partimento is the beginning of the composition study. Was the beginning, it was maybe the enough things for organists, for most organists who had to play a continuo during the liturgy and to improvise verses were 30 seconds the organ. So, for example, this Mattei verset Peter Ventura is preparing, and they are versets, they are piccoli bassi by Padre Mattei that are very short bass movement, bass figurations. That are also perfect to understand how to play a short verse between the Gregorian chant, because the Catholic liturgy, there was an alternate between Gregorian chant, organ, Gregorian chant, organ, Gregorian. So the organ played alone, without any cantus firmus in that age. At the beginning, yes, then the organist improvised without a reference to the cantus firmus of the Gregorian. And they played in a modern, more or less modern tonal system, neo-model, but was completely tonal. And the piccoli bassi by Mattei are exercised to memorize, very short, but are also perfect organ verses if you play in much more organ style. And then the organ style in Italy was in that age a completely harpsichord or keyboard style without no real difference. There were more use of dissonance, of stile legato, so the gebundene stile, the preparation of dissonance, but in generally is a harpsichord style, the organ style of Italy. You had any pedal, so.
You mentioned that you teach fugues when you are teaching counterpoint. What do you make of, does Padre Martini also teach according to that style, species, counterpoint?
Yes, Padre Martini, we know for sure that Padre Martini was one of the most, one of the earliest appreciator, I don't know in English, of Fuchs. He appreciated a lot the Fuchs Gradus of Parnassum. And I simply teach on Fuchs because my professor taught me with Fuchs in the conservatory study. So, and I use Fuchs. Of course, I use also the Selva di vari precetti by Giorgio Pacchioni, where he uses a lot of a comparison between the different sources of counterpoint. Also Zarlino, also Zacconi. Rodio, a lot of Cerreto, a lot of early Italian counterpoint treatises put in synopsis. So this is very important but this is more difficult than Fuchs. Fuchs is a little bit more modern, and his neo-Palestinian style is really not so much Palestinian. But for my organ students, I think this is quite enough. In the same moment, I start to teach the octave rule at the keyboard. We don't write, never. I let write only the counterpoint. This is written, but the Partimento is never written. They have also to memorize. It's very important to memorize what you find with the right hand. You know?
Do you ask them to play all keys right away?
Not all keys, no. Normally, at the very beginning, I start with very simple keys. Yes. C major and major. Yesterday I taught some Partimento in Bergamo, and we started with some Durante Partimento, for example, very simple, because they are very good for the beginners. They are very clear. You can find the structure. You have some hidden double counterpoint in the Durante Partimento. But it depends a lot from. In general, I like to proceed in an individual and experimental way with each and single student. So it's not always the same. It depends a lot from the level of the student. If the student is a very good organist, he memorizes a lot of fresco body, Bach, Scarlatti, music in the hands, is much easier to arrive to a good style in the Partimento realization. No? And then I want that they never write. Sometimes we repeat for 1 hour, 2 hours, the best solutions for a Partimento. I offer some solutions, and we record some videos on the hands, only on the hands, so they can remember at home what we did together. But it depends. Of course, if I teach to the organ student, because I'm professor in Genoa for organ and organ composition, and in Bergamo for harpsichord and historical keyboard. So the goals are different, because the organist has to write fuguettas in three parts, and this is obligatory. The harpsichordists have to play continuo in ensemble normally, so the goals are a little bit different. I use Partimento for both courses, but the Partimento for harpsichordists is very important, but it may be in the curriculum is less important than for the organist who have to compose and improvise on the choral. So do you understand? So I work a lot on Partimento, and also in Bergamo the organ professor now is a very good improviser, and he also work on Partimento in the organ classes. So we want to organize also some concerts with students who play some concert only Partimento, but of course this is an approach.
But what are some common, because you are teaching, very experienced at teaching Partimento, what are the things that you see are the common problems that students have, setbacks, things that they have trouble with?
In general, I think that the problems and common setbacks I usually encounter, the passage and progress from the chord harmonization to playing with the diminutions. So typical of the solo realization of a continuo, the diminutions. So when they pass from the chordal harmonization and they have to play, for example, in two parts, the bass and the right hand only with one part. Also, some good organs who know very good the traditional harmony, you know, has a problem to invent some cantabile melodies, you know, and something who is typical of so, but it depends, of course. We know also Fetis testified that the Italians didn't play Partimento in four parts like chords. The Germans more, the French has not really a Baroque Partimento tradition. They played only harpsichord continuo like accompaniment of singing of instruments. But of course, in Germany and France, they played normally, as I told you, in four parts. Italians, not. Italians tried always to have singing melodies, movement, violin-like movements in the right hand, or trio sonata texture, so two violins in the right hand. And so this is the most common setbacks, I think, that how to learn a student. And of course, there are students who know very good. It's very important. I use in the last years this Partimento treatise by Auguste Panseron. Auguste Panseron was a friend of Rossini, who was French, and he was a student under Mattei in Bologna. And he wrote in 1855, if I remember well, an important essay on Partimento, Traité de l'harmonie pratique à l'usage des pianistes. And this was the one of the standard books in the Paris Conservatory, where there were, like, after the Italian tradition of conservatory, two classes: harmonie pratique, so partimento, the keyboard, and harmonie théorique. And the harmonie théorique, of course, was built in France after the Rameau system of inversions of fundamental basis. But the harmonie pratique, Panseron, of course, shows also the triad inversions and the Rameau system. But Panseron gave a lot of samples from Mattei, Fenaroli, Cotumacci, and he also wrote, composed very nice partimento fugues, romantic fugues in partimento form. And he indicated in the treatise that exemplary models for the realization of partimenti are the keyboard works by Johann Sebastian Bach, by Domenico Scarlatti, by Handel. And when a good student knows it, he know how to treat the bass movement in a very very nice way. Because I tell always my students, now we do this partimento, but you have to forget a chordal. You must know which numbers, which intervals you have to give for this note, for this movement. But forget to make a continuo, like if you play with an orchestra, and then Italians played with orchestras with 10 voices together, with 12 voices and full hand down. But this is another story. But forget this very, very, very boring style, and you try to give pleasure to the listener. So this is important.
Now, you mentioned fundamental bass theory and Rameau. You mentioned that you don't teach this, and can you explain?
No. I teach to forget. I was very lucky because I don't know this theory.
Oh, you okay?
I completely don't know the theory because I studied always from my own continuo system, because I had Bach cantata score, so, and I saw these numbers and I understand alone what to do.
But no? Professor Messori, isn't it fair to say that there are some 18th century composers that did use fundamental bass theory, like Mozart maybe? They went...
Mozart maybe knew the new Rameau system, but I think that the problem is when you... Martini, for example, was completely against the Rameau system, and another very famous, most famous anti-Ramist is Johann Sebastian Bach. Johann Sebastian Bach, and Carl Philipp Emanuel tells Wright that he and his father, like every real true musician, are very distant from the Rameau mathematical theories. You know that Rameau composed like a wonderful clavecin improviser. And opera composer, one of the best never. He composed after the continuo system, not after Rameau theories. The Rameau theories are naturalistic interpretations for theoretical things, philosophical things, that has nothing to do with the emperor. When you sit down at the keyboard, you how to start a prelude, a little prelude. You think movement of the bass. In the tonal system, movement of the bass. If you forget the imitation, the fugal system, and the modal fugal Renaissance Zerlino system, so contrapunto alla mente, that is much more great and much more difficult. But the very simple Baroque system, that is very simple. You think to movement of the bass. The libro per accompagnare by Padre Martini. Every exercise you found also in Dandrieu, for example. These are bases you can, if you make diminutions of these bases, you have still preludes, little cadences, like Padre Mattei verses, like every. And so you have only to think to the movement of the bases. So which grade represents this movement, but not. If there is a fundamental bass and a inversion, so the six is opposite to five, is not the first inversion of the trio.
Right.
See, this is completely. If you want to interpret, to make a philosophy, I studied philosophy, but this is not important at all. It's very important for the theoretical approach, but not for the practical one.
Does your understanding of Baroque music, do you see that make sense for things like Chopin, Rachmaninoff, Debussy, Ravel?
For Chopin, for sure. So the important things is the harmonie pratique in France. The same thing in Italy was called accompagnamento or numerica. The classics were numerica in Italy, accompagnamento, partimento, the same thing. Or in Germany, they called it in general, general bass. So it was the same approach. In the Romantic age, they followed to study the harmonie pratique, the practical harmony of the keyboard. And this was taught with Fenaroli, with Mattei, because they were the most systematic, I could say, the last, the most modern, the classical, the classics, the neoclassical tradition, Fenaroli in Naples, Padre Mattei in Bologna. And Padre Mattei produced a lot of people who went to Paris, also Fenaroli, the same, a lot of teacher in Naples, in Paris. But the tradition of the studies, organ studies, composition studies at the very beginning in the Romantic age were the same. There were only more possibilities, less rules to prepare. You cannot prepare all of the appoggiaturas, we understand. So there are more. You are less strict in the Romantic age. You can use the fourth, sixth chord more freely. And before was a dissonance. Now is not so much dissonance. No? But Chopin studied organ. The only studied by Chopin, made by Chopin in Warsaw, were the organ studies. The organ, the class was organ und general bass. So they didn't study Bach, prelude and fugues like I teach now, no? But they studied the organ improvisation. So the Partimento, Puccini studied organ in Lucca, and the Puccini made the Partimenti by Mattei, the Partimenti by Fenaroli, and this was the organ study. The organ method, Italian organ method of the late 19th century, Maglioni, Arrigo, they have the first beginning, the octave rule. And I have also used the Kalkbrenner treatise for the pianist, because I had a real piano virtuoso student and also composer. And we have worked on the 19th century Partimento style. So Czerny, Zechter, Hiller, the friend of Rossini and Verdi, wrote this book of practical exercise, and there are also in the appendix beautiful realization for several scoring for quartet, for wind quartet.
So you don't see, like, for instance, if I go to Ravel or Debussy, do you also see
This is a little bit different, I think, because they did the harmonie pratique in this system for sure. But more and more there was a influence of the theoretical approach of harmony, inversions, fundamental, but in France, clearly, on the practical way. So, but when they destroy the tonal system and they find new roads, new ways to express the musical feelings, they, of course, they have also the Paris Conservatory was also very, very important for the theoretical approach to the harmony, to the composition. So they think new combination of fourth, of seventh. So this is, of course, for Debussy is another thing. But for example, if you take the organ music by César Franck, that was of a German-speaking family in Belgium. The organ music by Franck, also the last three chorals, you can put the traditional, very, of course, very complex, very modern, but traditional figures. And you have all the chorale by César Franck clearly explained. I did I did it for my study. So, and Brahms, for example, the fourth, the draft of the beginning of this fourth symphony, there are the figures. There is soprano, bass, and for the inner part, there are figures. So Brahms composed, of course, like Schumann, like Mendelssohn. You can see also the Mendelssohn exercise of under Zelter. There is the Partimento, so the general bass system, because this was normal. And also the very much more interesting, I find, the Riemann, Hugo Riemann functional harmony system, that is much more interesting than the degrees harmony in post-Rameau. I studied it in the university, but for example, in Germany, normally, I know that is the normal system. Also in Poland, the students in Poland use more the functional harmony by Riemann than the French traditional harmony, and the Hugo Riemann system, who is more philosophical, more idealistic, but also a little bit more interesting, because there are three functions: tonic, subdominant, dominant. And of course, this came from the inversion of Rameau, but there are also the numbering on these functions, the continuo number figures. No? So there is something more, is always analytical, is not practical, I think, but is more interesting because there is the tension from tonic to subdominant, from subdominant to dominant, and then the rest on the tonic again. No? So this is much more interesting to understand the tonal system, I think.
Have you seen a change in interest in Partimento over the last few years? Have you seen more people interested and interested in wanting to learn Partimento than before?
Yes, this is for sure. There is, I think that a colleague of mine in Genoa some days ago, a librarian, a musicologist, has told me, but now everybody asks about Partimento. There is a new fashion. And and I think that she's true. Because, and of course, this is very important. But sometimes it's a little bit also, it's a bit strange from my mentality. Because to speak about Partimento is to speak about the didactical system, historical system of Baroque age, of a little bit different of the Romantic age, of in another way much more horizontal of the Frescobaldi age. So now the tendency is there are a lot of fans of Partimento. They came from early music, from continuo, and they play Partimento, the harpsichord, wonderful thing. But maybe they don't study enough also the how to go further with fugues, with how to write a Baroque da capo aria. We understand. So I'm a keyboard player, of course, and I play. One of my jobs is to play continuo with others. So this you can do with a simple choral, or you can do with 10 voices in full hands, like Italians. You can do with a lot of diminutions. If you are the conductor from the harpsichord, if Bach played harpsichord, Bach played much more with diminution ideas than I think Vivaldi, that was a violinist, maybe. So we know that Bach played a duo sonatas and transformed it in a trio sonata with right hand obbligato. And Forkel tells it. So Carl Philipp has told to him, to Forkel. And of course, Bach used the pedal harpsichord, the pedal clavichord to play continuo. In Germany, the continuo, for example, continuo in Germany is one important thing because it was played normally with pedals when possible. The organs played the part, the partimento, so the continuo also of a cantata, with pedals. And their left hand played normally chords, maybe three-part chords. And the very good organists were also able, like Bach, to play in another keyboard a obbligato part improvised, like a solo violin part. So these are things impossible in the Italian system. We had not such independent pedal boards. No, we had a pull down pedal board. Not so much virtuoso use, of course, of the pedal. Italians didn't like to have. They were oriented to vocal thing, to theater, to opera, and so. But the Germans like the organ. Also, Luther was important for the Lutheran theology was important for this, of course. So Partimento is now for sure a wonderful new fashion that I like a lot, of course. I'm also influenced by it because, but I remember that the bass by Mattei, by Fenaroli, I had home when I was 13. So, Luigi Ferdinando Taglierini, which was one of the most important founder of the early keyboards in Italy, maybe the most important, played the two keyboard partimentos by Bernardo Pasquini, the sonatas for two organs or harpsichord in San Petronio with Marie-Claire Alain in some recordings of the 60s. When in the last years of his life they asked him to write again in a better form, write down these partimentos realization by him of Pasquini, he didn't want to publish, to let publish. Now they will be published in some month, I think. I know it from the Tagliavini brother. But he didn't want really to do it because he told me, he told one thing I believe also, that it's better to do it. If you are able to do, you don't need to publish, you do for yourself, and you do. If you are not able to do it, better don't do. So, yes, of course. And of course, it's very important to teach. And the problem is, the gap is that for 100 and more, we didn't teach in such way. Maybe only the organ composition course of the Italian Catholic tradition has a little bit followed the tradition of a practical approach on the keyboard, or the composition as a keyboard, do you understand? Because Partimento is a composition at the keyboard, I think. I agree with Edoardo Bellotti approach in general. That is a little bit, I don't see really that Naples is one of the great schools, but not the only, not the most important, because personally the most important basso continuo composer was Johann Sebastian Bach. So we have also to see how in Saxony was taught the composition. Langlotz manuscript, the Langlotz fugues are very important to understand the heritage of this world, no? Handel fuguetas for the London princess, the Kirchhoff things, the Matteson Partimento. Of course, all this tradition came from Italy, but there were also very important productions in this field, no, in Germany. So we studied too much Fenaroli. I think Fenaroli is wonderful. Luciano Berio studied Fenaroli. Verdi studied Fenaroli. We have also now to consider that we have also Johann Sebastian Bach's tradition. And this tradition created the romantic music, and so we cannot only understand that the best movement of Fenaroli are in principle the same by Bach, the same by Martini, by Mattei. So when you know this, but Fenaroli approach was three parts, not so chordal. No, the French Fenaroli tradition became more chordal. But the original Italian tradition was not so called, was like a paesiello, a cimarosa sonata. You understand? A cimarosa sonata. The cimarosa sonata are perfect models how to do a partimento in Fenaroli age. We have also to think to Sebastian Bach, to Handel, so I cannot only to teach one way. So I like also that normally our...
Is that Partimento with a small p? The Germans, they didn't call it Partimento, right?
No, they're Bassen, Bassetti, little basses, the same. But
solo, continuo?
Yes, we have the Mattheson pieces, the Handel pieces. There are other Saxon things. Peter Ventura is studying. There are the Kirchhoff pieces, the Langlot, the two preludes of Fantasia and Fugues by Bach that are wonderful and are for sure by Bach because are completely different from the Kirchhoff things. The two famous and discussed attribution to Bach of the two preludes and fugues, D major and B flat major, are wonderful Bach music in Partimento form. And of course, there is a mixture of Partimento and concertato style, like in the Partimenti by Aristori, like in the Neapolitan Partimenti. For example, in Bologna, we had not the tradition to write Partimentos with concertato parts in high clefs, you understand, like violin parts. This in Bologna, in Saratelli, there is not, in Padre Martini, there is not, in Padre Mattei, there is not, only in the fugues. In Naples, in Ristori, who was also one here in Naples. And in Germany, we have also the tradition to write the Partimento in a mixture of continuo bass and some concertato parts like violins, no? So high parts for the right hand. For example, there are beautiful organ sonatas who Michele Chiaramide, a colleague, also clavichord maker from Rome, he has published now this book of Partimenti, so organ sonatas by a priest, a friar, a Franciscan friar, Benedetti. And there are beautiful organ sonatas, very difficult also technically, in Partimento form, with also pedal, Italian pedal part, offertories, fugue.
This is amazing.
And these are beautiful pieces.
Now, you know what? Now, after this interview, I have to learn how to read in four clefs now on the keyboard. I have to learn Gregorian chant. And now I have to do...
Last little thing about Gregorian chant is very important for Partimento, I think. Because this is
That's great, because I have started trying to learn Gregorian chant because I started going back to church again, and so I started getting into... So what is the connect? Is there a connection, Partimento and Gregorian chant?
Yeah, there is a connection, and this is not very much known today, but I have some very interesting studies from the beginning of the 19th century, German studies. So we tell normally the Gregorian chant in Catholic Church was never accompanied. That the organists played solo organ in alternation with solo Gregorian chant. No? But this is not at all true, because in Italy. So, but in South Germany, after the Lutheran Reformation, also the Southern German Catholic started to sing Gregorian accompanied by organ. And so we have from the middle of the 17th century till the end of the 19th century also, so everything changed with Solesme, French friars. This was completely a hiatus. But I have these books who shows how organists accompanied the Gregorian choral, and they put under the Gregorian exactly the same like Lutheran multiple basses chorals by Bach, Schule, Kittel, Humbright, and many other. They put a Partimento with numbers, with figures, under the choral, the Gregorian chant. And this was a normal tradition in the abbey churches, Catholic churches in Bavaria, in Austria. And so Mettenleiter in the Sicilian movement, the Reformation, he wrote the complete Catholic liturgy in neo-modal style, but was written with a right hand, so treble was the Gregorian choral, And then there was a continuo, so a partimento with figures, in order to accompany all the Roman liturgy. This was, I don't remember the age, the year, but 1885, something like this. And of see, the Sicilian movement, so Regensburg. Yes, of course, but this was a long tradition who starts in the Schutz age, but for the Catholic, not for the Lutheran. In Germany, we have less things like this in Italy. It's true. Maybe the Italians alternated the organ solo and Gregorian solo. But in South Germany, there was a use of continuo under the Gregorian. So to for organ, so this is an important approach to the partimento. So,
but if you want to learn for the organ solo, you still have to learn partimento, right? That would be helpful.
It's important, yes, completely. It's impossible to separate the understanding of composition and the interpretation. And this is the most important thing. It also is completely important for me. Really, I think it's impossible to achieve some kind of artistic maturity if we talk about keyboard instruments and also in general without tackling continuously the compositional interpretation problems of ensemble music for voices, instruments, in the most disparate genres of the past. The same for the partimento practice. We cannot see only partimento and not the fugue. The choral composition, of course, if you are only an organist, you for an organ verset is enough to have a good ability in the partimento, in baroque partimento forms. But if you want to improvise in more modern style, of course, it's important to see the partimento structure of Nocturne by Chopin. Because Chopin, you can put the numbers in all nocturne, you have a basso continuo composition with a very free melody, of course. But this Bellini style taken in Paris by the virtuoso pianist. But the system is the same. There is only more difficult, more interesting, more genius harmonic develop. Like Bach is much greater. Sorry, than every Durante, Padre Martini, and because he knew he was more genius than them. This, and also the culture was different, so you can develop organ virtuoso with pedal, with many manuals, and so the things were different. But of course, Durante in Naples was an excellent teacher of that system, in that age, in that culture, for that jobs, because you must finalize always for a job.
And Martini too. Martini, incredible teacher and a fantastic.
Incredible teacher. Incredible. If you were from Bergamo, like Donizetti, Bologna was near to Bergamo, more than Naples. But Donizetti, after it, went to Naples. No? And of course, Meyer, the professor of Donizetti, the first German professor in Bergamo by Donizetti, Meyer, the teacher, Johann Simone Meyer, he was a student of a Bergamo composer who studied in Naples with Fenaroli, with Sala, I think, if I could remember. So these were the three best schools in the 18th century were Naples, Bologna, and the Bach School.
Well, it's been such a great delight and privilege to speak with you, Professor Messori. His latest album is the complete harpsichord and organ works by Johann Kaspar Kerll, a new 3-CD box. Now, Professor Messori, what's in store for you next in 2021, and what are your future projects and plans?
As for my latest project, I'm currently working on the post-production of the recording I made on a beautiful clavichord built by Joris Podvliege, of the Inventions and Symphonies by Bach. So now the next production will be a clavichord album with Bach music. I'm going also to record the complete partimentos by Giovanni Alberto Ristori. And my idea is to record on the Ristori organ still existing. He was in a Dresden chapel, now he's out in Saxony, out of Dresden, in the countryside. And to use this organ, the historical organ of the Zimmermann school, a little Catholic organ in the Lutheran Saxony, maybe an original harpsichord played by Ristori, that is now in Dresden, in the Schloss Pilnitz, Grebner harpsichord. But this is a little bit more difficult for budget reasons, but I hope to have enough luck. And also at the clavichord, and maybe some Partimento on the Zimmermann fortepiano also, because the Zimmermann fortepiano was also widespread in Dresden, only in Dresden, maybe in the 40s, we know for sure. And it's absolutely possible that Ristori played many times with his students that were the noble Saxon princesses and princes, his Partimento collection. And these 28 pieces are really one of the most important Partimento collection if you speak about art and really artistic music. And then I have played in concert 14 of these Partimenti till now. There is maybe also a live recording in YouTube of it. And I'm going to record this seriously. When, of course, without to write anything, of course, but I hope that my memory will be enough trained for it.
That's brilliant. Thank you so much, Professor Messori, for coming on to the Nikhil Hogan Show. I hope to speak with you soon. Bye-bye now.
Thank you. Bye-bye.